Hachette Audio presents You Are Beautiful and You Are Alone, The Biography of Nico, written by Jennifer Otter Bickerdike, read by Christa Lewis, with an introduction from Jennifer Otter Bickerdike.
Introduction. As Marianne Faithful once said, what I have in common with Nico is the understanding of her furious frustration at not being recognized. I was very, very late discovering Nico. One night I was out with a friend discussing our personal female rock heroines. I was both surprised and honestly totally mortified to find that compared to all the men in music that we loved, the list of women we could come up with was so full woefully short. Upon getting home, I admit I'd had a wee bit of wine. I did a bit of research to see what fantastic females I had forgotten. It came to Nico. She was in the Velvet Underground for that one crucial record. She had the Chelsea Girl album, but what else? I started to look a bit deeper into her life, my years as a PhD student researching pop culture, making it natural for me to really crawl down the rabbit hole of this enigma's history. At the beginning, I assumed I would unearth the usual story of rock highs and lows and comebacks, an eventual career playing at county fairs and heritage gigs, maybe some dancing on ice, that sort of thing. Instead, what I found was a life of myth that became more surreal the further I dug. Almost every aspect of Nico's life has been haphazardly recorded, if accurately chronicled at all. The repetition of the same anecdotes has somehow mutated random incidents specific to contextualized moments into grand brushstrokes of overarching truisms. The more I tried to find out who the real Nico was, the greater rupture became between the oft-repeated myths, the few documented facts, and the personal memories of those who knew her best. Any new crumb of information was hard-won and precious, often the result of weeks spent digging in dusty and long-forgotten archives, months of scanning through old microfiche, and countless emails and phone calls, all in the hope of discovering something not previously known. More than 100 new interviews were carried out in pursuit of establishing a more well-rounded understanding of the icon. What emerged was a didactic example of apathetic misogyny and stereotyping on the part of written history, a narrative that lazily rests upon the familiar, salacious, and utterly predictable realms of sex, drugs, and rock and roll excess, without acknowledgement of the unique and often unnerving life circumstances of the singer. At first, it just seemed too simplistic to blame the quagmire separating the two versions of Nico on nationality, misogyny, and cultural expectation. Yet the more I learned about her, the more obvious this explanation became. There were very, very few women writing about and documenting rock music at the time that Nico was alive, and even fewer brave enough to break societal expectations of what or how a female could be as an artist. This meant an often one-sided narrative was created and perpetuated about Nico, as there was no other female voices to challenge it or offer a counterpoint. From her name to the diametrically opposed persona she inhabited over the span of her life, it is hard to discern who the real Nico was. It's not been an easy task to tease apart fiction and folklore from often long-forgotten fact. The majority of Nico's life was spent as a solo artist with little formal documentation. There are also numerous conflicting claims about her, ranging from when she was born, 1938, 1942, to her political ideas. Some places it's written she was a Nazi, some places it's written she was Jewish herself. And though hardship and horror are common threads throughout Nico's story, so are moments of humanity and humor, such as the singer's love for making brown rice and vegetarian soup. "Always have an onion," she once told a friend, or her attempt at seducing a potential partner with a box of Cadbury's Roses chocolates. Silver aspects of Nico's life are certain. Born in Cologne to parents of Spanish and Yugoslavian descent, Christa Pafkin carried with her the guilt and unease of being brought into the world and raised in Germany during World War II. Her father, Willy, was drafted into the Wehrmacht, She never saw him again. This would haunt her for the rest of her life. Nico was a persona created one day in 1956 when a fashion photographer, Hermit Tobias, suggested to the then teenage aspiring German model that she should change her name, causing a protective shield between the fragile survivor and the public character to be forged. The nom de guerre paid off as Nico began landing modeling jobs for fashion hard hitters across Europe, including Vogue and Elle. She moved from modeling to acting, most notably scoring an unforgettable cameo in Federico Fellini's 1960 art house masterpiece, La Dolce Vita. After being encouraged by a lover to try her hand at singing, Nico eventually found herself at artist Andy Warhol's notorious factory in New York, a hub for outsiders, creatives, and nonconformists. Warhol and his collaborator Paul Morrissey had just decided to work with a then-unknown band, the Velvet Underground. The duo agreed to fund the fledgling group if they let Nico front them as the visual element. While the Warhol days boast ample images, anecdotes, and interviews, the later, perhaps more authentic version of Nico, the 2 decades spent touring the globe as a solo artist, has been virtually lost and rarely discussed. This has created a vacuum, allowing Nico's legacy and impact as a cultural icon to be often solely defined by her supposed superficiality, which sees her cast as a racist junkie who slept with a myriad of famous men. Her fellow Velvets Lou Reed and John Cale are consistently hailed as American masters, poets, and legends, their creativity and talent the main focus for the dispersion of such accolades. When physical appearance, sexual exploits, political leanings, and substance abuse issues are woven into the overall tapestry of their stories, it's often as part of the expected journey for any real artist. Yet Nico's genius contributions to rock culture are often overlooked, her value to contemporary music trivialized to her simply being a beautiful mannequin for the Velvet Underground. Nico's 5 albums post-Chelsea Girl, many of which are now considered undervalued treasures by critics, showcase a polluted, heroin-addicted, henna-haired singer with a repertoire of songs that are focused on the morbid and the dark. It is the demise of her legendary appearance, not the music, that are often remembered. Though her otherworldly beauty granted Nico access and opportunity, she also saw it as a hugely problematic attribute that prevented her from being taken as a serious artist, not just a female performer with a pretty face. Her apparent need to destroy this valued asset was not lost on those around her. As the years went by, the few press write-ups Nico received often hastened to note that, along with her deteriorating fan base, increasing age, and 15-year opiate addiction, she had lost her fresh-faced youth. Even her former benefactor, Warhol, called her old and fat in 1980. People rarely saw or acknowledged the woman who could speak 7 different languages fluently, read classic literature voraciously, and could finish the New York Times crossword puzzle in near record time. Nico's continued determination to make music, seemingly against all odds, whether fueled by artistic ambition or a need to fund her drug abuse, along with the empty concert halls, abusive fans, and the uncertain and often perilous reality of being an aging artist and addict, have often been cast aside in our cultural memory. This makes her story a chilling modern narrative on the fetishism of beauty, ageism, and the romanticization of death at the cost of a talented, lonely, and eccentric musician's life. As a solo artist, Nico created mesmerizing and thoroughly unique projects that inspired a generation of artists, including Henry Rollins, Morrissey, and Mark Almond. She was a true bohemian who deserves proper recognition for her brave, ballsy, often weird, and always deeply personal albums, which create a template for the modern genres of rock, punk, and goth. Her untimely death in Ibiza in 1988, not from a drug overdose, but instead the result of a bizarre bicycle accident resulting in a severe cerebral hemorrhage, has elevated Nico in the context of popular culture from a junkie hanger-on has-been to legend. In 1966, Warhol proclaimed her a superstar simply for being Nico. Yet it is Nico's determination to be an artist in her own right, regardless of commercial success, pop accessibility, or societal norms, that has made her posthumous legacy authentically iconic. The real story of Nico is one of determination, self-destruction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.